People are getting all kinds of information across multiple platforms. They hardly, if ever, believe what is being said to them isn't a lot of spin loaded in it. So therefore, my proposition to this audience is actually that silence is golden, so long as you have done a lot of thinking ahead of the curve. So if we take, for example, I assume that some of you have seen the WhatsApp on a particular food ordering app recently. Has anybody seen it?
I think everyone has, and we'll stop. I mean, have you stopped ordering? I don't know.
Right. So I have, you know, Rohil, the feeling that silence is golden. If you have done your work, you've anticipated to the point of paranoia all kinds of things that can potentially be thrown at you as a product, as a brand, as a service, as the behavior of each and every employee potentially, then you know, speaking is out of turn. Not speaking after this is happening has already hit WhatsApp and our timelines in various social media is a mistake. So silence is golden so long as you can afford it and you've planned for it, as in the case with Deepinder Goyal, my friend in Zomato. He did the right thing by writing a blog and explaining what all corrective measures they have taken and so on and so forth. So I hope I'm able to throw the gray in this very clearly, right, that there are no absolute black and white in silence versus speaking, but there is a great benefit to all of us as corporate communication leaders, as people on the high table or feeding our leaderships with thought processes, that a lot of planning can happen well before the event. And that's what we should be actually focusing on, rather than some press statements and some blue in the face hollering on television. To my mind, that doesn't really help.
Right. So feel free to come in if you have any points, because this is a collaboration, not only me, even you guys can ask a question. Feel free. Let me just raise your hand, whoever wants to ask. Okay, please. Can we have...
You can also just name yourself.
Please. Yes. Can we have a mic?
You can take this if you are short on mics.
Okay, one second. We'll just... Can you take this mic and so that we could, everyone could listen to you? Yes.
Hi, my name's Aseem. My name's Aseem.
Aseem.
Yeah, hi. So in that case, when Maggie decided not to be silent or be silent, what was it which was actually keeping them back? Or what would have been the right time for them to either decide I speak or I shut up?
So Aseem, it's an excellent question. And this happened when I was in an earlier avatar, and some people in you know, that company did speak to me in some context. So the whole point I've tried to endeavor here in first 2 or 3 minutes, Aseem, is that the planning has to happen much earlier. And therefore, you are a little better prepared for war, rather than at that time mistakes being made in best endeavor, and then people you know, regretting them. Because I suspect that a lot of mistakes happen in quick succession, because there is an intense pressure to perform, to show your counter-narrative, to bring in all sorts of ideas on the table. It's too much talking here.
I'm sorry, can we have a little bit of silence on here?
No, it's fine. We can give them the mic.
No worries.
It'll be much easier.
yeah, I think they were discussing a question, I think. Yes, please go
on. They're probably preparing the next question for me. So I think leaderships have to understand that they need to do scenario building a lot earlier. And then I think, like we have in the ancient system, that if someone else speaks for you, you are better off than you speaking for yourself. So if your brand has had conversations in the format that exists today, which is short duration, WhatsApp endorsements, somebody narrating their favorite Maggie story in a less in-your-face way, those are the peacetime initiatives which come in very handy, as and when. But I have the benefit of hindsight, so do you. No two companies can be similar in their approaches. At Jio, we speak very little. At Reliance Industries, we speak even lesser. But there are a lot of others who talk about it, which is really welcome.
Right. Are there anyone else wants to raise their hand? There's somebody, I think, at the back. Yes, please, yes. Can we have the mic there. No, she's just coming so that everyone could hear you properly. Yes.
Hi, I'm Aparna. I'm a faculty at Pearl Academy. I wanted to ask you a question about, say, like personal PR. So, for example, I'm sure Donald Trump also has, like, you know, they have the presence. So what happens in this situation where somebody is firing off tweets without thinking about it? And there are people who are representing him. What happens in that situation? I'm just curious about that. Like, he does do a lot of, like, absolutely insane, crazy tweets. What happens to the team? What does the team do at this time? How does his PR team handle this?
I would think that while the general narrative, Aparna, is that Donald Trump does what he said you do, he does. But my submission is that he is politically a lot smarter and a lot ahead than, say, the person he defeated in the elections or many other people in his tribe. He's able to simplify foreign policy. He's able to understand what his core constituency of the white male voter wants, even female voters want. And he's able to simplify it. And then the PR machinery around him probably is often asleep when he is actually in front of the TV and tweeting. So I'm by no means endorsing that as a strategy. But to my mind, it is extremely specific. It gets him the exact messaging that he wants without loss, transmission and distribution loss, which is often the pain point in PR. And it's a good political strategy. And increasingly, if you notice, many leaders, including in India, are using Twitter as a very focused way to communicate precisely what they want, and then they withdraw. And that gets amplified in the mainstream. So mainstream is picking up a lot of conversation. So linking it to the question that was just asked, if you have narrative which is leading into the leader's tweets or leader's social posts, then that becomes a bit of a multiplier rather than doing it when bullets are flying at your brand at that time.
Okay, before anyone else goes, I have a question for you. So which is, we've seen this viral video which we've spoken about. Does it also mean that brands are being watched very intensely? Does it put an extra pressure on brands to be always there on their toes? How is the brand side thinking of not getting the brand diluted through these kind of leaks?
I think all of us in the room will agree that the cheese has moved and that people are watching all the time on a 24/7. Therefore, you have to be planning for these situations and also communicating the good that has been done. In the food ordering space, for example, Rohil, I was speaking to the owner who I mentioned in the passing. He has hired 30,000 drivers in the last few months in a particular region alone. And just about anybody with a class 12 certificate and a bike is given 35,000 rupees as a one stop per month payout. And then they bring in the bike, they bring in the petrol, and they bring in the maintenance. So typically a 12 standard pass in the Zomato setup takes home 15 to 20,000 bucks. So just for context, if the brand had communicated, I have the vantage point of illiteracy here, but if they had brought out the employability, the employment, the side of the driver in peacetime, that comes to good stead in when there is a unfortunate situation. But they handle it well. I think the blog by the owner was well taken. It was very honest, it was very prompt, and the advantage with founder-led companies is that there's less bureaucracy. So the founder then takes over and does it. But it's best done a lot earlier with a lot of diverse narrative and presumably in a snackable way which people are today able to absorb, but also share. So what you get, there should be that X factor in it for you to want to share it. And company plugs and what is classic Copcom stuff, or even what agencies, I dare say, write, is definitely not shareable. It looks like it's written by the company. And nobody wants to be party to sharing what the company has said, but they are happy to do it if somebody they respect or somebody they like or somebody said it in a slightly more wacky way, they are happy to share it. So that's the time to build your defenses rather than when somebody is found opening your box and eating.
There's a gentleman there. Can we have the mic, please? Yes. So we have 3 minutes left. We'll go 3 minutes.
Yes. So make your question 3 minutes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Dr. Ramesh Gandhi, and I'm director of Center for Social Change and Communications. my question is regarding the Rafale deal. What BJP has done wrong from PR point of view? And
okay, we have to be a little apolitical, but I mean, sir.
No, it's not political. Okay. From PR point of view.
Okay, sorry, I'm sorry.
My question is specifically and only from PR point of view. About the Rafale deal, what do you think the BJP has done wrong from PR point of view? They are not, have they properly tackled or not tackled? And why there is some part of silence from Reliance Defense on this part? How they can better manage?
Right, so one of the parts that Rohail has flagged is silence is golden. So I'll take that. And I will also like to tell you that Reliance Industries has nothing to do with this. So probably it's a little bit of a mishmash on this, where I don't have a locus to analyze what a company has done or not done. It's not my company. But I can say that as far as communicating is concerned, in defense, there are far many more constraints to come out with the pricing and with the specs of the aircraft which are supposed to defend you when you know, the cows are coming home. And there could be a problem there. In Zomato, it's a lot easier, you'll appreciate, than in, say, the case of how India has to be defended by a particular a conglomeration of manufacturing, offsets, and pricing, and what product is being actually compared with what. So I'm not really well qualified to address it on multiple counts, but I've read your blog on Zomato recently, and you made some eminent points, which ultimately I think a lot of people, Mr. Gandhi, should be listening to.
Sorry, there's time for one more question. Yes, please. Okay. Okay, we'll take two questions. We'll take one more, and that's it. I'm sorry, I'm going over time.
Hi, Rohitji, I've worked with you earlier. Quite a privilege to be.
Keep your mic closer, please. Yes.
Yeah, I've worked with Mr. Rohit Bansal earlier, and it's been quite a learning for me. I want to ask one question, sir. You've been editor of in the media, and then you've been in corporate communications with Reliance for so long. So which one is better? How do you?
That's a very tricky one.
But what do you feel is because you've seen both the sides now for quite some time.
Which side is better?
Yeah. So I was never quite a distinguished editor, Ram, but I did become an extinguished one very quickly.
That's quite modest of you.
So I think none of us take wrong decisions. We do what is truly in our bestest interest as a. In line of what the market is, what you're able to get, what is your likelihood of succeeding, and so on and so forth. No one knowingly makes a mistake. So to my mind, what I do is the best job on the planet. And that is exactly what I felt when I went into India TV, which was 8th or 9th in the ratings, or when I went to Financial Express, which was a distant number 3 after Business Standard and Economic Times was like Amitabh Bachchan.
Yes, sir.
First 10 places taken. Yes. So to my mind, whatever we do, we should at that time embrace it as really the culmination of all the factors that go into a decision. Not for me, this business of comparing one career with another, with one company with another, or even for that matter, comparing one city and the other, because I'm often asked which is better, Bombay or Delhi, and I kind of get flummoxed. I really don't have an answer. Why would I live in Bombay if Delhi was better?
Yeah, absolutely. Right.
Thanks. Sorry, we have only one question. Time for only one question. There's this gentleman, and you can take this offline. I'm sorry, yes. No, on the right, yes, this person. Yes.
Hi, sir. My name is Rishi. I look after the sales for LocoBuzz, which is into the digital listing and all. My question is very simple. Recently, there was a case for Make My Trip. A lot of people were saying that they are canceling a lot of bookings even after they have booked it. As a brand, they took all of the precautionary measures. However, it was really difficult to understand from a consumer point of view that which is the story which is correct. So, I mean, in such kind of situation, what a consumer do?
So you have to start 3 months in advance, if not 6 or if not 9 months in advance. You cannot be reacting just right at the last minute. So I'm not familiar what Deep Kalra did beforehand. I'm not sure if the narrative on what all Make My Trip does is good. But I know for a fact in your founder's case, Vishal and Shubhi,
yes.
They are able to track data. So to my mind, Make My Trip should hire Locobus and figure out what social conversations are, how they are building up well before they start trending and people start panicking. Because you have in your own company software, I'm sorry if I'm doing a pitch for Locobus, but a lot of good companies and even political parties are today able to discern conversations well and truly ahead of the first 20 trend lines that emerge on our Twitter feeds as public people. So to do that even before Locobus triggers come is the point that I have endeavored to make. That's my through line for this entire 10 minutes that Rohil and the organizers have afforded.
Okay, so we will, this gentleman is insisting, so we'll take that last question. That's it, and that's final, yes.
Sir, I just want to know, not about brands, but on the personal level, and especially when you're in public life, either you may be a celebrity or a politician, if somebody targets your image, like just for example, Me Too, 80% of the cases were just fraud. I don't know if they would
Can we keep
agree
the question short? I'm sorry.
And right from that level to a personal level in a room, like you're talking to somebody and somebody comes from behind and says, hey, beware of this man. So, and it's only because of jealousy, anything from jealousy to conspiracy.
Yes.
So how do you handle that, you know? And
invest early. So if you have people who will stand up for you, they know what you're all about. Yeah. It's always better if somebody defended you from another side rather than you coming and becoming upset or blocking that person or replying in an impetuous way. Give it 24 hours. Most people say things in a very abrupt way and then don't really mean it when you engage with them. Likewise, those who are silent never underestimate the power of the silent, tweeple or the silent man or woman on the
sometimes
internet.
Sometimes you do not know.
I'm sorry,
we
will take this offline. We have to end it here. I'm sorry, we're running out of time. Thank you, Mr. Bansal, for this insightful conversation. Can we have a round of applause for Mr. Bansal? And
you.
I would request, sir, to be on stage. And I want to invite. Sir, I request you to be on stage. Mr. Raj Suri, Indian-Australian influencer, brand consultant, to felicitate Mr. Bansal. We can play some music, maybe.